All right, well, we'd like to invite you all out today. Thank you for coming to hear Dr. Ron Reigner talk about acrology, which is an interesting concept for those of us who have no fear of heights. So.
That's a good way to put it. No fear of heights.
Thank you for coming. Back in about 1972, when I was in college, in all the student newspapers, there was this little magazine called Nutshell that some company that advertised all different kinds of products that college kids needed put this little magazine called Nutshell in all these student newspapers. And I was an undergraduate at Emory, and I was reading this little Nutshell magazine one time about this guy named Dr. Paolo Soleri, out in the desert in Arizona, who was trying to save the world. And when you're an idealistic undergrad and you say, do you want to save the world? If so, you must come and help us do this, all in capital letters. And I thought, well, I guess I better go do this kind of thing. And I started investigating. I ordered this book. This is called Arcology, the City and the Image of Man, and believe it or not, right here on this page it says, this book is about miniaturization. Well, maybe when a book is about miniaturization, but it's this big, you have to wonder what the heck people are talking about. This is now quite a collector's item, even though it's slowly getting battered to death. I now have a smaller version also published by MIT Press, so it's worth a little better. Let me start by, how do I go to the next slide? Just bump something?
Space bar, arrow right or left click.
Oh, that one, that one, that one. No, I don't know how to change it. I don't use laptops, sorry. Page down, page up.
Left or right would work.
Huh?
Left or right, try right.
This one?
You can
do a space bar or you can do a right. Oh, okay, thank you. The liveliness of man's world is hindered by the physical extension of his shelter and the spatial dilution of his institutions. What the heck does that mean? Dr. Soleri, who didn't even speak English when he first moved to the United States, even though he had his doctorate in Europe, within a couple years was publishing books like Technology and Cosmogenesis, or The Bridge Between Matter and Spirit is Matter Becoming Spirit. And the man developed quite a vocabulary. What Dr. Soleri is talking about here is stuff is too far apart. To get from here to the grocery store, to the library, to wherever you want to go, things are spread out too far. And the analogy we like to use is each cell in your body has a little job, and your body only gets so tall and so wide. Some people get taller than others, some people get wider than others, but you only go so far and you have a skin and you stop. Dr. Soleri says a city should be like an organism, and it should have a skin, and it should stop. And if it overgrows its skin, you develop a new city, but you don't just let the city keep going and going and going and going, because in the average city in the United States, about 40% of the land area is taken up with streets, parking, gas station, and parking lots. In LA, it's over 55%. 55% of LA's land is actually car devoted. And so Dr. Soleri says we're looking for what we call an urban implosion. We're going to implode ourselves this way. And so, let's see if I do this right. A city must be predicated on compactness, because lack of compactness is lack of efficiency. You've got pipes and wires and all the different kinds of things to make a city work. Everything is basically two-dimensional. Even though we got some tall buildings in downtown Atlanta, I'm from Chicago, we got some tall buildings in downtown Chicago, but basically we are two-dimensional. And if a city was more three-dimensional, and we've actually had some minor little attempts at things like that. Colony Square in Atlanta, Marina City in Chicago was designed to be a little work-live community. Colony Square is right across from the High Museum on Peachtree Street. And it had a big ice skating rink in the middle of it, and grocery stores and barber shops, and it had apartments and condominiums and office space. And all that was designed so if you wanted, you were always welcome to walk out the back door or the front door and go where you wanted. But you didn't have to get in a car to go from here to go ice skating, from here to get groceries, and from over here to get your hair cut. Kind of like the little miniature community my mom lives in, the retirement community in Stone Mountain, where they got the bowling alleys and they've got the swimming pools and they've got bridge and canasta and all that kind of stuff, right? Okay, now what I'm going to try to do is I was going to shrink this one, and I was going to go down to this guy. I can't explain half as well as I can show you a little bit about what Arcosani is all about. Thank you. 1974, I hitchhiked out to Arkansas from Knoxville, Tennessee. Actually made it in 3 days. Some guy driving a big old Winnebago picked me up and took me two-thirds of the way, and he was stuck driving. I was taking a bath, sitting at the kitchen table, doing this, doing that. He was stuck up there in the driver's seat, driving the whole way. But he was glad to have company because he was going out west to meet his wife or something like that. And he had this Winnebago, and he just picked me up off the side of the road. The cops had actually stopped me for being out on the interstate. And this guy came along and said, "Hey, you need a lift?" And the policeman said, "Go ahead." And so I got to ride in a Winnebago for the rest of the way. Dr. Paolo Soleri is probably as much a theologian and a philosopher as he is an architect. And one of his mentors is probably Teilhard de Chardin, the French priest and paleontologist who helped discover Peking man. And Teilhard de Chardin, we had sweatshirts at Arcosani that said, "Work hard, play hard, Teilhard." But if you didn't know how to pronounce the French, you wouldn't have any idea that you had a rhyme going there. Teilhard de Chardin is the guy that said that in an environment, as we go through evolution, things become more complex and more unified. And Dr. Soleri added to Teilhard's ideals of complexification and unification, he added miniaturization. And he said the most complex thing we know is the human brain. In that little space inside our heads is just stuff that no computers can do yet. And it's just all that stuff compacted in a small, small space. And Dr. Soleri also says, the city should be considered a living organism that, as it evolves, necessarily becomes highly complicated and spatially compressed. That we can't just let cities keep going horizontally across the landscape, but they are to start and stop. Here's a city. You want to go out to the woods, you walk out the back door. At Arcosani, where I worked in Arizona, Dr. Soleri is building Arcosani on about 18 acres of land, and he has 800 acres of land. Now, normally a city of 5,000 people would take up 800 acres of land with streets and gas stations and grocery stores and you know, movie theaters and everything else. Instead, you're compacting all of that into a three-dimensional thing that takes up about 18 acres or whatever it is, 13 acres maybe. And then the rest of it is cattle farming and it's just the mesa. It's just north of 70 miles north of Phoenix, about halfway to Flagstaff. It's actually kind of below the major tree line, because you get to Flagstaff, you're talking woods, woods, woods. Arcosani is a little below the tree line, but they've got the Italian cypress and some of the other stuff they've got growing there. And so I went out there in 1974, and I dug ditches and poured concrete and hammered nails, and went back in 1978 and dug more ditches and poured more concrete and hammered more nails. We also had a big festival in 1978. They started having festivals try to raise awareness in the world about Arcosani. In the late 60s and the 70s, we kind of had a lot of counterculture stuff going. And so while I was there at the festival in 1978, let's see, we had Todd Rundgren in Utopia. We had Richie Havens, who had opened Woodstock. I was the stage guard, me and a couple other guys, to keep people off the stage when Stephen Stills from Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young was up on stage. We had Otto Peeney, who was an MIT professor of visual arts, who had put up that rainbow, that big giant inflatable rainbow over the 72 Munich Olympics. And Anders Holmquist from Denmark, who is a vexillographer. Raise your hand if you know vexillographer. That's banners and flags. If you design banners and flags, you get to call yourself a vexillographer. And it's just exciting stuff. Otto Peeney had us build this giant Mylar blanket that was about 20 feet wide and 50 feet long. It had helium built into it. And we all took it up on the top of the mesa. There's about 50 of us all holding this thing. And we just went one, two, three, go. And we let go and it just floated away. And that was it. And we understand it came down about 40 miles away, you know, finally landed. I don't know if it landed on somebody's house. Hopefully it didn't land on somebody's car while he was driving along. But we were pretty much in the middle of nowhere at the same time. Let's take a look at what else I got up here. When Paolo first got his doctorate in Italy, he came to the United States and he worked for Frank Lloyd Wright as an apprentice, which is why I think he got that whole, well, it's very European. It's
this apprenticeship model. You know, you go work for a cobbler, you become a cobbler. You go work for this guy, you learn how to do whatever this kind of trade is. And Frank Lloyd Wright, the famous U.S. architect, had his workshops out in Taliesin, which was just a little east of Phoenix in the Scottsdale area. And Paolo came there, and you just did the master's bidding. You did whatever it took to do to be part of the workshop, to work along with the great Frank Lloyd Wright. And Paolo was there for about a year and a half, and then he broke off from Frank Lloyd Wright, and he and another architect who had been working for Frank Lloyd Wright formed they kind of lived out in the desert in a tent practically, but they got a commission to build this house called the Dome House, which got all sorts of architectural accolades because it's set down in the desert floor, and the top of it completely revolves around. And you can open it, you can close it, and one thing that the lady who lived in it did was, one part of the top is opaque, and you always move that to keep the inside in the shade. So when the sun's moving across the sky, you move the opaque part, it just all revolved on a big runner, and you could see kind of the track the way it worked. You could open it up, two-thirds of it could be open, but you could also always keep the inside of the house in the shade without the sun beating down on you. Because when I was pouring concrete at Arcosani, I mean, we got up about 4 o'clock in the morning, and by 1:30 in the afternoon, you couldn't be pouring concrete. It was just too dang hot. And I learned very quickly why people in the Middle East wear like long white stuff, because you were better off in a long sleeve short than a short sleeve shirt. Because as soon as the sun hit your skin, you die. But if you keep your long sleeve shirt down to here, then at least you're keeping the sun from just beating to death on your skin, and you actually stay cooler, even though you had more clothes on. I know that seems weird, but that's how it seems to work out there. Dr. Slattery also got into designing some things like bridges. This was featured in the Corcoran Gallery in Washington, D.C. And this bridge called the Beast was an actual model. It was about 18 feet long. Somebody dropped it and broke to smithereens, so it no longer exists. But if you look at it very carefully, what it is actually it's a tube. And it's a tube with a road down the middle of it, and wherever the tube didn't need to be to hold the tube shape, to keep it having some strength, its tensile was this way, I believe, Dr. Slattery just cut away. So sometimes the tube wraps underneath, and sometimes the tube wraps above, but what that did was that actually supported that model. And we thought we could have built a real bridge with something like that, but that never happened. But that was a lovely design, and it's in all sorts of bridge. And this is just an example of Dr. Slattery's sculpture, and I brought this because I thought I just had to show it. This thing weighs a ton. This is an original Slattery sculpture. It is heavy. It's called Madonna, and it's made, you know how they make jewelry with lost wax, where they put wax in something and they pour in the metal and the wax disappears and the metal fills up the space? This was actually done with lost styrofoam. Dr. Slattery carved this out of a piece of styrofoam, that he packed it real tight in river silt and sand in a mold. Then they poured the bronze into one end of the mold, and you can even see a little spot where it came in, and there's a little tiny spot where they had to cut it right in that spot. Mm-hmm. That little dot is how they got it all in there. And then once it's dried, you just break the mold apart, and there's your sculpture. And that's actually how Dr. Slattery makes all the wind bells and things that I'll talk about in just a second. But this is at the Phoenix Art Museum. It's called Il Denone. And it's kind of very Picasso-esque, if you ask me. Just this giant lady flying through this giant cube. That is pretty, and it's huge. I mean, it's got to be 20 feet long. It's really a big piece. Okay, let's start talking about how, as Dr. Slattery, you saw in the video where he was doing some scribbling on paper. He actually went to the butcher shop and bought butcher paper that was like 3 feet wide and 100 feet long. And he rolled it out on a table, and kind of like Michelangelo with Michelangelo's notebooks, Slattery would draw these things and write all these notes and slide some more paper down and draw some more and write some more notes. And so those are very, very valuable. They've been displayed in museums and things. But as he started thinking about the complexification and unification and miniaturization of urban areas, and people seem to want to be living in urban areas. And in
one of the slides where it says that crowdedness is not a bad thing, crowdedness is a good thing, because you don't have symphony orchestras out in the middle of rural nowhere. You've got to have enough people in the same place to put enough creativity in the same place where people bounce stuff off of each other, and you get symphonies, and you get artist colonies, and you get writing colonies, and what have you. They normally don't happen just with hermits here and there. There are some hermits out there that do that kind of stuff. So this actually happens to be a model. It's about as tall as I am, made with billions of little plastic blocks. And it's for the city of Hexahedron. It's just a concept for 170,000 people. This is the one that pretty much blows people away, because it's a city for 6 million in a structure, which we can't even build today. We don't have the technology to build this complex. But in the next slide, I'll show you, there's the main Babel. Each one of those areas in that tower is like a neighborhood, a whole neighborhood, just one stacked on top of the other, on top of the other, on top of the other. And that shows you what it would look like next to the Empire State Building. So we're talking pretty dang big. Now they're building pretty dang big buildings over in the Middle East and the Dubai and over in, somebody's got a mile-high building design. Of course, Franklin Wright designed a mile-high building that never got built. There's one that Skidmore, Owings and Merrill has designed that may go up in Taipei or Singapore or something like that. Who knows if the funding will come about. And the latest thing I was showing, this book, this is Dr. Slary's last book. He died a couple years ago. So Dr. Slary is no longer with us. But his last book that he published was this one called Lean Linear City. And he talked about not just an arcology and an arcology and an arcology and an arcology, but just kind of connecting them. And so what we've got here is these neighborhoods, each one with the windmills and the solar vortex and all that kind of stuff. We're talking about 3,200 people for each one of these before you get to the bigger areas, which is where urban areas and coming together kind of things are going on. There's another picture of one of the models of the Lean Linear City. Now, when I first got to Arcosani in 1974, here's what Dr. Slary had in mind. There were like 12 towers that were each round, and they were only about 15 stories tall, and they were in this rectangular area, and there was going to be a roof system over the whole thing. With at each of the corners, this shape is called an apse. An apse is a quarter of a sphere. And what a quarter of a sphere does, if you face it the right direction, especially out in the southwest, is the summer sun, which is very high in the sky, keeps the inside of the apse in the shade. The lower sun, which is much lower in the sky, comes into the interior of an apse and helps warm it in the wintertime. And so it's that passive solar energy use. But he's kind of got one of the apses facing in all the different directions. That was the original model of Arcosani back in the early 70s. Pretty soon, and back when I was there in 74 and 78, there were probably about 250 people at Arcosani at the time. My workshop had 45 people. There was a workshop right before me that had 53 people, and the workshop that came 2 weeks after, they overlapped every 2 weeks, and you went out for 6 weeks. Now, this sounds I don't know what to call it. You had to pay to go work at Arcosani. You paid tuition, and you paid room and board. And my dad said, what kind of a gimmick is that? This guy, you're paying him to go dig ditches for him. Well, you paid for the privilege of working for Frank Lloyd Wright, and we paid for the privilege of working at Arcosani with Dr. Paolo Soleri. And he would meet with us semi-weekly or twice a week, and we'd sit around and just have philosophical discussions. We'd ask him questions about the world and the universe and questions about doorknobs. And he'd be thinking in all these different levels in terms of how this should look. Kind of like when Frank Lloyd Wright would design some of the women's clothes for people that bought his houses, and the dishes and the plates and the spoons and the cups and the saucers. I don't remember if Soleri ever did any cups and saucers or spoons. Well, when that many people were out there in the 70s, pretty soon this idea of a city for 1,500 wasn't going to work. And the next model of Arcosani was this model. This is a great big apron across the front that's all greenhouses. And this was actually a 15-story building and a 20-story building tilted. And it's kind of a horseshoe-shaped. So the taller one is in the back, the other one's in the front, but it's got all these levers and things so that you can keep the sun out or you can let the sun in when you want. And it was basically, like I said, a 15-story building and a 20-story building, both tilted. And then there was a whole inside that was your inner urban area. The outside was the skin. When you wanted to go out, you just went down and out whatever door you were, so you were back out. You didn't have to get in your car and drive 25 miles to get to out. You were just there when you got done. Now, that was probably designed for about 3,800 to 4,000. And the newest version of Arcosani that you saw at the end of the video is this one. And again, we're going back to a lot more of the apse shape. And a lot of these curved things, Dr. Slary called like layers of an onion. And that each one of these layers helps build upon each other in terms of in front of and spaces in between. Supposedly, in an arcology, a family would have a space that would be like 20 by 40 by 60. Well, how many square feet is that? 20 by 40, or no, 40 by 60 is 2,400. If you did two stories, I mean, you've got a lot of space. But Paolo had a space at Arcosani that after his wife died of cancer, it was the, I mean, talk about frugal. I mean, this man's stovetop had two little burners on it. I mean, he just didn't even want a four-burner stove, because why do you need a four-burner stove when there's only one of you? And so he turned down commissions all over the world because his whole life was spent on this Arcosani project. What you see in this picture is that model, and all the stuff that's built at Arcosani so far are these colored buildings down in front. So really what's at Arcosani is not really part of the project at all. Well, it's part of the project. What Dr. Slary said is we have to create what he called a critical mass. And he figured a critical mass would have to be a little mini city of at least 500 to 800 people, and then that would finally get the impetus going to start building the real Arcosani, not all this little peripheral stuff. The peripheral stuff was going to work and it was going to blend in, it was going to fit, but it's not really any of the major urban piece that Arcosani would have become. Now this is a screenshot from the sky. I worked on that building, the Crest 3 building, when it was only three stories tall, and we poured concrete to build the next floor up. This is the foundry where they make the metal wind bells. Back there is the ceramics, that's where they make the ceramic wind bells. If you don't know what a Solari wind bell is, there's somebody on St. Simon's who I knocked on his door the other day who has about a dozen of these in his front yard, way up in the trees where nobody can steal them. This is a Dr. Solari wind bell. It is also poured in a mold made out of river silk. And every single one is different because after they make the shape in the mold, somebody goes in with little tools and does all this little design work that when you pour the metal fills up all these spaces. So this one's different than the very next one that was made, different than the very next one that was made, different than the very next one made. While I was at Arcosani the last time, I went down to Tucson where they're having a big exhibit of Paolo Solari stuff. And the Vatican had ordered a windmill assemblage that was supposedly about $65,000 worth. But I mean, it was half the size of this room. It was just huge with these big chunky things and bells hung from this and little chains hanging here and big bells and little bells and whatever. But this is a typical Paolo Solari windmill. And believe it or not, they are building a city by selling these guys. They probably have a budget at Arcosani of about $500,000 a year. You can't add two rooms to the Regency Hyatt House in downtown Atlanta for $500,000. And so here they are trying to build a city. At one point, there was some Arabic sheik or prince or something that really got excited about Arcosani. I'm thinking, well, if anybody could afford to build an arcology, it would be somebody in the Middle East who just got billions of dollars that they could just throw at something like this. It never happened. I'm not sure why or why not. Now, I also had ceramic wind bells, but the ceramic one I was afraid to bring because they break pretty easily. In fact, the one I had is a big chunk out of it. I glued it back together, and I won't even hang it outside anymore. I have it inside my house, but
And every one of these little pieces is, you know, is a little different than the one next to it. And so this is, sometimes when it's really, really noisy, I'll actually put a big paper clip on this thing so when I have down there, the neighbors don't start beating on the roof, going, hey, I can't sleep, the bell's driving me nuts. But the guy who lives over on First Avenue in St. Simon's, he said nobody's ever complained about his, and he's got a dozen in the front. He said he had more in the back.
Ooh.
He's a retired art teacher from the public schools, and he said he'd try to come today, but he didn't make it, so. But trying to finance a city on wind belt sales is a little scary. Now, I wanted to share, well, let me see if I can go back. What they've been doing in Arkansas for the last several years is this whole curved area called the East Crescent Complex, and right in the middle of it is the Colli Soleri Auditorium, where they do all the shows and the dance recitals, and musicians and pianists come out there. They're always having performances done. Dr. Soleri was very big on the arts as part of making us human and making us who we are, poetry readings and what have you. And the far complex over here, and all this is housing, some of it's housing, but there's housing in that building, there's housing in that building on the east and west side, there's actually housing around the foundry. There's no housing in the ceramics app. And over here are the library and the architectural dress offices, and then most of the curve is kind of like townhouse housing complex. And over in that corner is my claim to fame, because where you see these giant circles, I made those circles. Most of what you see at Arkasani is concrete that was cast on the ground flat and then lifted into place. I had to build a great big square out of wood on the ground, and then I had to design this great big circle in the middle of it. And it was like 8 inches thick. And then what we did is between the circle and the square, we put rebar, and then we poured in the concrete. And when it cured, they lifted it up. So each one of these giant panels with a great big circle, the ones that match, I was the guy who actually spent about 3 weeks all by myself making this giant circle out of plywood, and I was slowly having to bend it around the curve and bend it around the curve and bend it around the curve. And then it became the model for every time they wanted to cast a big square that had a big circle in the middle of it. And that's where those come from. You can always go back to Arkansas, and there's Ron's void. This is kind of Arkansas one of these days. There's a ceramic windbell. And what's cool about that is they actually make them out of liquid clay. They're cast in heavy silt that's got a shape. And then after they let it sit about 2.5 hours, the clay starts to form a skin, and then they just take an old scooper and they scoop out the liquid clay, and then they just let that clay harden, and so it becomes that shape. And then before it gets super hard, they break the mold, and somebody takes every single one of those bells and hand carves, and just carves different designs on them. So every one of those is different. The one I have in my office or in my house is Tomiyaki, the architect of Arkansas, actually made the bell I have. And this is the bell I covet. This is a metal bell. It's called a cause bell, and all that stuff at the top of it is when you buy a cause bell, there's one for Save the Whales, there's one for the elephants in Africa. This one is the literacy bell. And if you buy that bell, 15% of the sale of the bell goes to the Reading is Fundamental organization in Washington, D.C. that sends out thousands of free books. Well, that's kind of been on my radar for a couple of years, but unfortunately now it's gotten up to where it's like $465 for that one bell, and I keep thinking, no, I'm still having to repair my condo, I can't really afford a fancy-dancy bell right now. Maybe if I go out to Arkansas and they have a sale, I'll come home with a literacy bell one of these days. But so far that hasn't happened. Arkansas.org is the name of the website. And Arkansas has used this quote for a long time because it came out of an old Newsweek magazine. A lot of people respect Dr. Soleri. A lot of architects look at Dr. Soleri and say, oh, he makes nice bells. But you know, it takes some of the people who think way into the future, this kind of philosopher, futurist kind of person,
to say, help us get from here to there. And Paolo was never interested in designing rich people's houses because he turned down commissions all the time. Supposedly Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill, the people who did the Sears Tower in Chicago, and now it's the Willis Tower, they actually approached him one time about doing something, and he said, not on your terms. You know, he was just so picky about what he was going to devote his time and his energy towards. But good old Newsweek magazine said Arcosani is probably the most important experiment undertaken in our lifetime. And ever since they designed Arcosani, Paolo has been calling it an urban laboratory. He says, we have to build the lab to do the experiment, to see how this works. But you know, I've had friends that have had like exchange students from like Japan, and the Japanese kids come to an American's house and they say, you have 2 extra bedrooms upstairs. Why aren't people living in them? Why don't you rent them out? Why don't you do something? Why you got all this space, you know? And so there are cultures where people are used to being a lot more close and rubbing shoulders more than they are here. You know, people live in New York just fine, you know, and it's pretty darn crowded. But New York is the exciting town it is because it's got all those people doing the kinds of things they do there. And it isn't for everybody, and that's understandable. You know, some people want to live out in the woods, and some people want to live on St. Simon's, and don't want anybody else to move to St. Simon's once we get there. You know, at least I say to myself after I moved to St. Simon's, well, at least I bought a 40-year-old condo. They didn't build a brand new building for me to take up more trees, you know, by coming to St. Simon's. At least I bought something that was already sitting there, so I didn't take up any more of the world. But I think that Dr. Soleri did die a couple years ago in 93. The head of the Cosanti Foundation, and oh, I should tell you, the word Cosanti means against things. And Arcosanti is an architectural way of designing stuff that's against the whole track house suburbs that we're looking at all over the world, where you see areas of Phoenix that just go on and on, just rows and rows and rows of these little single family homes. And there's nothing wrong with single family homes, except they're horribly inefficient in terms of the energy used to get stuff to them and get from them to other things, and get the kids to school, and get to the grocery store, and what have you. And so the idea of pulling us back together, this urban implosion, take out the car first and see where we are, and then in terms of moving sidewalks and escalators and elevators and what have you, you know. But nobody at Arcosani would ever be stuck like in a wallless, windowless cubby. You've always got this outside experience, and you probably always got this inside experience. So you're kind of looking into the city, and you're looking out into the world. The city ought to have a skin that ought to start and stop at a certain place. And the guy who's now the head of the Cosanti Foundation, his name is Jeff Stein. He quit his job as head of the architecture school at Boston College, and he moved out to Arcosani, and he gets paid minimum wage to be in charge of the Cosanti Foundation. Because he was a workshopper when I was back in the 70s, and he just thinks this is something we need to be doing. Maybe not everybody, but maybe it is one answer or one way to show us that, you know, maybe in the future we're not just going to, I mean, you know, as they talk about cutting down the Amazon rainforest and this suburb and that suburb and tree canopy here and lots of tree canopy there, if we get people condensed in, then we can have, like Arcosani has, 5,000 people, except now it's only about 85 people. And there are people who have raised their kids at Arcosani. Those kids actually get on the school bus and go to the local school and come back every night and go to bed at Arcosani. And there are people who've gotten married and probably divorced at Arcosani. But there have been some people who have been there since the 70s, and it's just been their life mission. But Jeff Stein came back a couple years ago, and he's trying to do a lot more now. I mean, you're not going to let this die just because Dr. Soleri died, because they think it's important. And whether the gigantic complex ever gets built, they used to ask Dr. Soleri, and he'd say, he'd look at some little girl, and he'd say, that child's grandchildren. So he knew it was taking, he said, I'd be a fool to think that, you know, I should have spent, you know, 70 years of my life on something that I didn't think I could do. But he just thought it was something that was important enough that that's what he did do. Well, anyway, questions, comments, concerns?
So he had no end in sight. He had no time.
Yeah, he didn't really set a date that said, nowadays, they'll tell you Arcosani is about 3% done. I think in the video it said 2. Now they tell you it's about 3% done. But the trouble is, if he had stuck to the original 1,500 person complex, maybe or maybe not, that would have been a lot farther along than it is. But then it grew to 3,000, then it grew to 5,000. And so as the city itself got bigger,
the dream is 5,000 now.
Yeah, and so then the percentage of that is a lot smaller than what the same percentage would be if it was only a city for 1,500. You know.
I noticed those roads are not paved. Are they paved roads?
When you get off of the interstate, I think it's Interstate 17, actually, or 70, Phoenix to Flagstaff.
Yeah.
I think it is 17.
Yeah.
You get off at Cordis Junction, and then people have been complaining now for 45 years that it's a gravelly dirt road that leads you all the way back to the Arcosani complex. And if you're driving on the expressway and somebody says, there it is, you can go, oh yeah, and it's gone. So unless you get off to go, and now they say there's been about 7,000 people who've been workshoppers over the last 40 years. I mean, we're talking deans of architecture, the editor of Architectural Digest came out and did a workshop 1 year, and so a lot of artists and architects, a lot of kids from foreign countries who are studying architecture, who come from Asia, who come from Europe, who come from the Middle East, who come from India, and so we've had lots of kids who come through. A lot of schools will give academic credit for kids who do an Arcosani experience, kind of like the service learning kinds of stuff we do here, kind of a thing. You know, I should talk to Jeff Lemieux in the art department, and I have been chatting about, maybe I can go and talk to some of his classes and see whether some of the students might want to sign up for it. Now they've lowered it down to a 5-week workshop. It was 6 weeks when I went, and each time I went, I stayed about 2 months each time.
How many times did you go?
Three. I went in 74, I went back in 78, and I went back in 87. And since then, I've been back several times, but not to dig dishes and more concrete. But one time when I was first there, the very first workshop I was at, there was a lady whose husband was retired playing golf in Scottsdale, and she came up to Arcosani for the whole 6 weeks.
The limiting factor for any kind of development in the desert Southwest is water.
Right.
How was the need for large amounts of water to support all of these people going to be addressed?
Through the property is the Agua Fria River, which is a little tiny river that's usually underground, but sometimes it fills up a whole riverbed. And we had a Thanksgiving dinner out there one time, and we were all standing in 4 inches of water because the water just kind of came up from underneath. But I'm not sure if they've decided whether the Agua Fria would support a community of 5,000.
Not on a continuing basis.
Right. But you're talking a lot of recycling kinds of things that would go on, so who knows how much water recycling, like, you know, astronauts have to do on spaceships, you know, that they would contemplate in terms of the future like that.
I think it's so interesting that you called him a futurist when I see that he looked back into the past history of the Anasazi and the Pueblo Indians for their apartment buildings and the even the architecture, the growth, the organic feel.
Right, and you know what I meant to put in the slideshow, and it went in my head and it didn't stay long enough, was from the World's Fair in New York. Remember Habitat by Moshe Safdie, the famous complex where everybody had a little box, but your box had an outdoor space, which was the roof of the guy's box underneath of you. And it was all these boxes stacked on top of each other. People still live at Habitat. And it's on this island out there when they did the World's Fair that had that weird sphere at the same time. But if you ever look up Habitat by Moshe Safdie, who was a Canadian-Israeli architect, and it was really famous because they just took, and it was kind of that early idea of what do you call it, when they mass produce something, and if you do it in big enough numbers, the prices go down per unit because you're making lots of them. And they were just stacking these big apartments on top of each other, but everybody had an indoor space and everybody had some outdoor space, which was always just the roof of the guy underneath of you, you know, and you had a deck and an outdoor area on those. And Habitat's pretty famous. I'm sorry I didn't slip a slide in there. Because I think Moshe Safdie, who's been doing other stuff like that ever since, I mean, he's still an active architect, and he's done some fancy hotels and different tropical places where they just kind of climb down the sides of hills, you know, and each person's got indoor and each person's got outdoor, and they're designed around the land. And even though Paolo Soleri and Frank Lloyd Wright both had a lot of reverence for the land, they kind of went in two different directions in terms of what Frank Lloyd Wright did in terms of blending into the land with Taliesin in Pennsylvania and with Taliesin, not Taliesin, Falling Waters in Pennsylvania, Taliesin in Wisconsin, the other Taliesin out in Arizona. I should be able to answer that question, and I can't in terms of how much population they have enough water for there. But Cordis Junction has grown up over the last 40 years a lot more than it used to, so there must be water from somewhere, whether of course they could be piping it in. Like
the whole Southwest has that problem. Mm-hmm. And how do they address it? You know, the only thing they've done is dam the Colorado and try to.
Yeah, and look at Lake Mead nowadays, it's really scary.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a critical problem.
Yeah, well, they're talking about all the tree canopy of the whole United States may be affected because of how the weather patterns are changing and what that's going to do to us. And yeah, if we don't start fighting over water, what is there to fight over? Because that's the first thing you got to add.
On a completely different shift, in the Middle Ages, the most impressive building of a town center
was the church.
Later became the most impressive building in the city was banking and commerce. It appears as though he's trying a cultural shift here.
Huh.
To go back to residents and people habitats rather than these outside organizations.
And in some of the big slides, like where I showed you Babel Noah with the big giant tower, a lot of the other industry and stuff was kind of ground level, subterranean, where, you know, all those things still have to happen in an urban area.
But the emphasis is put on the people.
Exactly. Good point. Yeah. It'll be interesting to see what happens over the next, you know, 15, 20 years to Arcosani as without Dr. Soleri being the head guy there. But, you know, in a lot of ways, people thought he was too autocratic and a lot more might have happened if he had been a lot looser than he was about some things. But,
you know, they recently tore down the theater.
Did they tear down the one in Santa Fe? Mm-hmm. Yeah. He only designed three other buildings in the whole world other than Arcosani, and one of them was this, it looked like Salvador Dali designed this little outdoor theater at a little Santa Fe college or university.
The Indian school.
Right. And a lot of preservationists were trying to save that thing, and I hadn't seen that it finally went that they were fighting for. And you know, some of Arcosani is pretty crude, but it's idiots like me up there pouring concrete and doing what it took to build what it is. You know, but usually we had a crew leader that said, make sure you do this, you know. And so in terms of as big as it is, it's pretty impressive that it's a lot of people like me that just kind of went there and like little cogs in a machine, we just did our jobs, and what Arcosani is now is what it is because of that. If you're ever in Phoenix or Scottsdale, in Scottsdale there's like a miniature version of Arcosani called Cosanti, which is where Paolo and his wife Polly lived for years, and he tried out a lot of these different design elements things. He actually built a building where he built it up a mound of dirt, and he put rebar out there, and he took a kitchen knife, and he just dug little trenches, little V-neck trenches, he put rebar in there, poured concrete, dug out from underneath, put colored glass, and he had this amazing space with this weird web of a ceiling that was held together with these concrete tree limbs, was what it looked like. And there are bells down there, and there's this down there, and there's that down there. So there's all different ways that he was just experimenting. I mean, frugal is the word, because there's just never been enough money to do what they did. You know, he got some big speaking fees. He did win from the Smithsonian Magazine the year before he died, a Lifetime Achievement Award. From the Cooper Hewitt Museum, which is part of the Smithsonian Complex in Washington, D.C. So I always want to say to architects that say, Soleri, I say, well, when you win a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Smithsonian, come back and talk to me about it. Because I think there's been success even where we are, where it got. You know, I mean, it's proved some of its point. And I think now a lot of the world is catching up to the idea of let's not suburbanize the whole United States from here to there.
If I may, I had two things to add to that. So there's a community in Atlanta called Serenby.
Yes, Serenby. Yeah, I know where that is.
Yeah, they have 400 people who live on site, and the houses are very close together. There are no backyards, and there's a common green space, and you can walk to the grocery store and the school.
not exactly inexpensive, but
no,
but
incredibly
lovely.
Expensive, but
very thoughtful community, yes.
And it has the same concept of the skin, where you leave the city and then there's nature.
Yeah,
right next
to it. I've never been to Serenby, but I know right where it is. Peachtree City on the south of Atlanta supposedly did that, and everybody used golf carts instead of cars. I mean, you had cars, but they tried to put it close enough together. Well, I've been down there for some art festivals and things where these people are drive like maniacs in their golf carts, and so you can hardly walk without getting run over by somebody going 45 miles an hour in a golf cart sometimes. But you have another thought also?
Oh, I used to work at Columbus State University, and I absolutely loved it there. I was in Midtown, Columbus, Georgia. And what was so neat about it is it was incredibly walkable. I mean, you could walk to shops. I walked to my hairstylist. I rode my bike to work every Friday. It was 2.5 miles to the university.
Right.
And it was just such a neat, tight-knit community as part of the neighborhood association. And I don't know, just moving to this part of the world, I miss that. Now I have a 25-minute commute and everything else. And
right.
So anyway, very interesting. Thank you for contributing.
Oh, thank you. When I taught at University of West Georgia, I lived in downtown Carrollton. I lived in a little loft that had been an old sock factory, you know, and my mom would come and stay. Boy, was it so nice for my mom, because I would go to work and she would just walk to the little town square and have a coffee here and a Danish there and read the newspaper here and the bookstore there, and there was a bank, you know, and it was just that whole old-timey urban, you know, just, but see, my understanding is in Italy, that's very much what it's like. Italy is not very rural in terms of farmers don't live out there. Farmers live in little communities and they go out to work the farm, but they come back to where other people are. They just don't live on a farm way out in the middle of nowhere. They actually start here and go out to the farm and come back at the end of each day. And that's where you get all the stuff with, you know, farmers markets and people bringing in fresh stuff on a pretty regular basis from wherever they're bringing. One of these days, I definitely got to get to Serenby because I followed it in the Atlanta paper, and I go online every once in a while, and some really good Atlanta architects are involved with designing some of the structures at Serenby. But you know, also in Atlanta, they've got all these wonderful high schools that are turned into condominiums, and this giant old high school that finally went defunct, you know, is turned into this little condominium, and it's right there in Candler Park, or it's right there in Grant Park. And people are starting to realize that they just don't want to spend half their life trying to get from here to there in a little 2,500-pound box with four tires.
Yeah, there's certainly, Atlanta's terrible.
And Chicago, I think, how did I live in Chicago? But you know, when I lived in Chicago, I think my car went about 800 miles in a whole year, because between the trains and the buses, who in the heck wanted to get in their car to go anywhere? Mm-hmm. I'd go to downtown, I worked at a bookstore all day, then I'd take the train to the university, work on my graduate classes at night, home to the neighborhood where I lived, you know. But nowadays what's happened, like even in Chicago, is the little house I lived in Chicago, my friend paid $21 for it. He sold it for $185. It then sold for $400. And then I saw in the paper, because it was within a block of an L station, a train station, I saw in the Chicago paper the address I used to live, $1.2 million teardown. It was the dirt. The dirt that close to a train station that would get you to the airport or to downtown Atlanta. Now, I don't know if they sold it for about $1.2 million. But I told my friend Dale, I said, you should have hung on to that for a few more years. Well, thank you all very much for coming. I appreciate it.